you yeah. know, a host family for the people coming over.
Sure, it sounds like a great opportunity.
Sounds
you know?
Like an excellent opportunity.
And I'm thinking that I want to get on that trip in October to go down to Egypt.
I know. Mm-hmm. Oh, and we forgot to say, they call him Al. We didn't have to say his name.
Al is a lot easier. But
yeah, but he's
really
a great guy. We really, really enjoy having him on the show. Mm-hmm. And we thank you for watching.
Yep. Thank you.
So see us next time right here at top of the
morning.
At top of the world. I'm Betty Montgomery Williams.
And I'm Just Kumar.
Bye-bye.
See you.
You want the talent agents calling up and saying, I want Betty Montgomery Williams and Just Kumar.
We got up before dawn just to bring you
top of the morning from beautiful downtown Baltimore.
Hi to top of the morning.
The top of the morning to all of you.
Hi, top of the morning.
Edition of Top of the Morning. I'm Just Kumar.
And I'm Lil Bree.
We have a fantastic show for you today. This is a great show. We have Beth McDonald, who's a jazz classical singer.
Right, doesn't like to classify herself.
That's right. And with her is Alan Dale.
That's right, so, another great musician.
Another great musician, great drummer. So stay tuned.
We have some wonderful performances available for you.
That's right. So stay tuned.
The leader of the band that accompanies Beth.
Okay.
That's the way I would.
Yeah.
I used to say that she sings with my band, but things have really kind of turned around, and now I play for her.
Okay.
The emphasis has shifted to some extent. Yes. That's important, having fun doing what you get paid to do.
Yeah, absolutely. We were talking during the break, we also did a tribute to we just put together a show in this past year that is a tribute to the first female singer-songwriter, the first real famous one, who's Peggy Lee, and she is known for songs like Fever, and she wrote all of the music for Lady and the Tramp. So we just pay tribute to her talent, and it's a lot of fun.
That's wonderful. Yeah, and do you have a CD earlier?
That's my debut CD that came out in 2006, but right now we're working on two new recording projects, one of which is based, it's a children's project, but it's not the typical children's project. It's really geared towards parents of young children. Music that you can dance with your children to. So there's a lot of lighthearted stuff and a lot of sweet, you know, lullaby-ish stuff. But it's in the jazz realm for the most part. So jazz standards, but geared towards little ones. So, and the other one is recordings of stuff that we would typically perform in a live setting, like at the festival. We do a lot of private events and that.
Each of which will include original material that Beth has composed. She is a real songwriter and has been since she was very small. This features just Beth's vocal with a Celtic harp player, Jared Dinhart. It's absolutely divine, you know, sublime sounding
music. I know
music.
Jared Dinhart.
Some of the most beautiful music I've
ever
heard.
I'm sorry, I just stepped on your mom. I actually have footage of this, but you're close to the camera there. And action.
We introduced a really unique multi-instrumentalist friend of mine named Jared Dinhart, who's a, among other things, a beautiful Celtic harp player and a composer. And since Beth has written some tunes of real substance, real significance, I think, that are poignant and beautiful and lyrical and melodic, I wanted to see what would happen, and we were paying for it by the hour, so it was a chance we were taking. But we brought Jared in, he brought his harp, and we ended up with at least two or three different songs which feature Beth with just the Celtic harp. And it is simply the most beautiful music I've ever heard in the world. One is an original tune that Beth wrote. One is a tune which, for all I know, maybe Jim Henson might have composed, called The Rainbow Connection. And it's just, we're, you know, we always like, even with regard to live material, we don't like every song to sound exactly the same, with the same rotation, you know, in terms of the instrumentation, same solo order. So with this Lullaby album, which we're working on to complete right now, it'll include some interesting, some kind of unique instrumental elements to contrast with some of the, you know, more swinging, straight ahead stuff.
I'm doing both projects at once because I really couldn't make up my mind which direction to go. And right now, though, my heart is with the children's project. I have two small children, ages 2 and 4, and so it's been a lot of fun to put this together. And it's a huge honor for me. I'm coming out of virtually no experience in this world at all, and then I'm thrown in with these brilliant musicians who are truly geniuses in their fields. I'm really honored. I'm really happy and tickled about how this project is turning out.
We should mention another person with whom we're collaborating on this material, on these recordings, and that's an engineer named Chris Biondo. And Chris is an old friend of mine. I've worked with him on other projects, and we did one session at his studio. He's an Emmy Award-winning producer. He was Eva Cassidy's band leader and her bass player, and so he's on all of that material, and he works with collaborator Lenny Williams on soundtracks to movies and TV shows, National Geographic specials, things like that. But he agreed to let us come in. Of course, you know, him, I mean, you know, he's a nice guy, he's just not that nice. But he let us do this this thing. We went in at 20 minutes till 1 in the afternoon. And we left at 12:30 that night, and we brought our favorite piano player in from New York, and great bass player, trumpet player, and rhythm guitar player, and Jared with the Celtic harp. And by 12:30 that night, we had 15 tunes, each of which has a unique feel, possibly unique instrumentation, all of which was usable in some
which
measure.
It's
not very often, but it was a tribute to the compatibility, the chemistry of the participants, and that certainly includes Chris, because he's a great engineer and he's a wonderful guy, and he made Beth feel loved.
That's wonderful. I'm just curious, how do you classify your music?
That's interesting. Well, the kind of, it's funny, because when he first asked me to, he needed a singer for one particular gig, and I had never sung by myself in public.
Why is that?
At all. Because
why is that?
I was too scared. I wouldn't do it. And,
fear.
Not just fear, paralysis. You know, I couldn't do it. And he asked me, he really needed a singer. He had heard me sing with someone else and thought there might be something that could be developed there. And so I decided that I'd go ahead and pursue it, but I told him, you know, I don't like jazz. So when you ask me what kind of music, you know, when I heard that word jazz, I thought, no.
Yeah, you got a snack, right?
Right.
Well, you know, I thought, no, that's not me. That's really not me. And then he introduced me to some of the songs, and I thought, no, this is just, these are my grandparents' songs. These are old love songs. This is classic.
And she loved them.
I love this music, and I've grown to love it even more, but it's really the old style, traditional jazz. None of the smooth jazz, contemporary stuff. Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Oh, yes, there is.
not any of that. But we do a lot of the swing and really music from the Great American Songbook, the 20s, 30s, and 40s.
Thank you.
You're too kind.
Now, when did you start singing? I mean, you were a little girl, or when did you start?
Well, I've always enjoyed singing. I've always enjoyed music and writing music. I don't remember a time when I didn't do that. And my mom talks about me crawling up onto the piano bench and plucking out melodies and then doing it again the next day. And she didn't realize that until I kept doing it repeatedly that I was actually creating melodies. So I don't remember not doing that. But I was hesitant. Well, that's a little understatement. There was no way I would share any of that. I would record it and I'd write it down in my little notebook.
It was very personal.
But it was just a personal expression, you know, just something that I did, therapeutic, you know, to pass the time or whatever. So I didn't perform in public, like I said, let alone share any of my original material until I decided to go ahead and make the CD and perform with the jazz band. So,
awesome.
Baptism by fire.
Did you come from a musical family, like your mom and dad?
Yeah, they forced us, actually, to play at least two instruments. And I'm very grateful that they did. I played piano and violin.
Those are my two instruments.
Great.
Yeah, my mom was smacking with a little spoon.
I try to be.
Let me tell you, he's the greatest. This is not an understatement. He is the greatest living drummer.
Alan, what about you? I saw you banging out on those drums.
You play anything else?
No, I'm sufficiently challenged just to play, you know, four things at the same time.
But no one plays the drums like you do.
I had a privileged upbringing, improbable, good fortune or blessing being in the company of a lot of great legendary jazz musicians growing up. My father was a musician. I traveled all over the country. I became very, very close to a great drummer named Louie Belson, who was Pearl Bailey's husband and the only man who Duke Ellington ever acclaimed as the world's greatest drummer. So I spent years traveling all over the country with Louie Belson and being in the company of some people who were extraordinary human beings in addition to being great musicians, you know, very genuine and humble and gifted musicians, who were part of the fabric of an era in American popular culture, which is gone. These people were part of the world in America when America, as a gift to the world, among other things, gave jazz music, and the people who were representatives of America, who traveled the world and were treated like visiting heroes. People like Duke Ellington, Count Basie, and Louis Armstrong, and Ella Fitzgerald, and Nat King Cole. And these are the people, the era of the great composers, the Gershwin brothers, obviously Duke Ellington, Cole Porter, Johnny Mercer, people who defined what American culture was during a period of genius in American pop culture. The popular music was the work of these great people. Those days are pretty much over, but there's a small, you know, you can always find some cream of the proverbial crop. And there are people like Diana Krall and Michael Bublé and Norah Jones who are writing and performing acoustic, what we consider to be swinging jazz music. But jazz is one of these words like the word God. You know, lots of people use the word, but people have different concepts about what it means. And for Beth, it meant something that was sort of atonal and harsh and lots of, you know, successive choruses of saxophone solos, and that wasn't appealing to her. You know, we sort of facetiously, I hope, referred to her initial response to my request that she consider doing a New Year's Eve job with us. It was, you know, kind of a high-profile thing. I went like this. And she, first, her initial reaction, well, she doesn't like jazz, she doesn't know any of the tunes, and she wasn't that crazy about me. Other than that, it was an enticement that she could hardly refuse. But she, the thing I want to say about her, though, is there are two things. One is that she's a real musician, and I think real artists, it's more than what they do. It's a manifestation of an essential part of who they are, what they are. This has been something expressing herself in an artistic way through her lyrics and through the melodies of her tunes is something that's been a part of her life since she was a tiny, tiny little girl, even smaller than she is now. And the other thing is that it's the easiest thing in the world to do things that are easy. Like, I've been playing drums since I was 5 years old, so I don't think about it. It's like breathing. I don't worry about it. I don't think about it. I don't want to think about it until it's happening, you know. I don't want to have anything prepared. I don't want to be preoccupied with that. I want it to just happen. And it's much more challenging to do something that's difficult. And believe me when I tell you that one of the things that I most admire about Beth is that her participation in these collaborations with the great musicians, with Chris Biondo, you know, all of what we're doing is dependent upon her willingness to do something, to take that initial step, and to go beyond that first step, because every moment that we've performed is a snapshot of where we are at that particular moment. And some people get to a snapshot and they stop. But we've actually done a concert now where on the marquee it said The Temptations, and then the next line was Beth McDonald. You know, when we started, it was Alan Dale and the New Legacy Jazz Band, and now it's Beth McDonald. Okay, well, that's right. But I want to just, you know, commend her, not just because she's a beautiful artist and the music that she's writing and creating. She's taking empty space.
Wow, well, let's have a look. Happy month, 1922.
It's good to be paid to do something you enjoy, and you know, and I'm hopeful that I think it's actually self-evident now that Beth is someplace where she knows she fits. Mm-hmm. She's not out of place. She's not ill at ease. She's increasingly comfortable.
It took a long time to get there. I felt like, you know, every time I walked out on stage that it was just ridiculous. And even now I laugh sometimes. Like, this is so silly. My name is up there in life. I want to laugh about it, but it's all good. We're having a lot of fun, and I'm doing what I really enjoy and what I believe I was meant to do. Hard or not for me to do it, it feels right.
That's great.
And she has the support of her husband, her children. Well, actually, they cry when she leaves, but if they were older, I'm sure they'd be supportive. And her parents.
My son said this morning, I'm mad at your singing. He didn't want me to leave, but this job allows me to be.
Her parents, her sisters, her in-laws are all supportive and make a contribution to making it all work.
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay. So what's your next tour, your next gig?
Well, we perform all the time, and we're always looking for venues in which to perform, too. We do a lot of private parties, a lot of corporate events, and the next thing, I guess, we're doing two private parties this weekend in Virginia.
Yeah, but, you know, with regard to the public thing, we always update at least Beth's website, which is simplybeth.biz.
B-I-Z, yes.
And that she has an upcoming, you know, performance page, because most of this, really most of the work we do is private.
You could also order the CD. You can sign up for a mailing list there now if you want to be notified about when the new projects come out, which we anticipate publishing in the next couple of months.
Yeah.
So there are all kinds of things you can explore there. You can contact us if you want to hire us for a job, even if it's not, however you want to do it. And so it's all there, simplybeth.biz.
Okay, great. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Thank you all for coming on the show.
Our pleasure.
Thank you so much, Jeff, for having us.
Thank you.
It's nice to meet you.
The music is great.
Thanks.
The music is fantastic. It's only
forever. Only forever.
Only forever.
For CD.
Okay, back down.